This is the new Seat Ateca facelift. And here on Autogefühl, we'll go through all the changes in exterior and interior and what we can expect from driving this new Ateca. So please join us as usual in Full HD, full screen and full length. Let's go! Please subscribe to us if you haven't done so far, and thank you so much for all long-term subscribers. Here in the front, the Seat Ateca, you can see, takes over the front grille from the bigger brother, the Seat Tarraco. So the outer frame is now like this. It's wider, it's bigger, has a stronger stance on the road. Also, the front hood has been changed, and there are also new trim levels. This is the new trim level Experience. It replaces the other top trim, Excellence, and you can see it has a more off-roadish look. So in the lower part, we have the silver contrast right here. By the way, the ACC sensor also went from the top part to the lower part right there. Interesting. So a more modern look and a stronger stance on the road overall. And LED is now standard. Not only the daytime running light, but the main headlamp unit is LED now standard and then in two different trims. However, no matrix LED available. The very concise grille form on the inside, by the way. This again here with the shiny dots. This is reserved for the Experience version. It will look a little bit different in the other trims. There's also still the top sporty trim, the FR version. We'll also talk about the differences later on. And of course, here the daytime running light. When you switch on the turning indicator, it has this famous function that it replaces the daytime running light. Looks always quite fancy. 4 meters 38, 14'4" or 172 inches is the length of the Seat Ateca. This, of course, hasn't changed because the real hardware underneath is still the same for this facelift. There are new colors. For example, this one is called Dark Camouflage and also new wheel designs. It starts from 16-inch directly aluminum, so no steel wheels anymore, and the maximum would be 19-inch. That's, for example, right here what we can see, the top 19-inch wheels. This Experience trim here and also the Sporty FR trim come with 18-inch as standard and then optional bigger one, 19-inch. As for suspension, you start with the base suspension, then optionally can go for the DCC, dynamic chassis control. That's the adaptive suspension, and we would also advise you to go for that. This Experience trim, again, with the more off-roadish look and, for example, once again, the silver contrast in the lower part. This will then have a darker color in the FR, for example. And what's also interesting, you have the crossover wheel arches here, but in the standard model, it would have a plain black plastic look. In the FR trim, it would have vehicle color. And then here in the Experience trim, you can actually see that with your own eye. And also when you touch it, it's like an extra coating, so it looks more sophisticated. It's also black in the contrast, but has this finishing on the top part that it looks cooler and also feels a little bit better. So one of, you know, my favorite details about this facelift here. Other than that, you can see here the chrome frame around the windows. And once again, the design line is above the door handles and actually also a quite strong C-pillar here. But make no mistake, it looks actually, you know, quite large already, but it's really a small car as for the exterior dimensions, so it's still good to park in and out in the city. The Seat Ateca now with the facelift also receives a new so-called ClimaCoat front windscreen. It's not the one that is built in here at the moment, but if it would be, you can see some kind of a like greenish layer. And the thing, what it's actually for, you can actually defrost the front windscreen in about 3 minutes, so when it's really completely in ice, then it's all clear vision again. And also at the same time, due to this coating, it's also reflective, so it reduces the heating up of the inside cabin, so it just reflects the sun rays. By the way, supplied by Saint-Gobain, so that's one of the, you know, the big corporations that are all the way over in glass production. So pretty interesting new thing. It's already known from the Tiguan and the Golf, by the way. And there's a new puddle light here underneath the side mirrors. I'm showing it in my hand here. You see here, hola, for Spanish hello. So this will be the pod light that will be displayed also on the ground, but it's just too bright here, and with the bright floor, you can't see it on the floor, but it will be, of course, in, you know, in darkness. But here at the hand, you can see it. That's also appearing right there. There are also some new visual elements here in the rear. First of all, the Ateca writing is in this more emotional handwriting here. And it doesn't say like AWD or 4Drive. That's their brand name for the all-wheel drive here. Just the 4 and that's it. That means that's one of the all-wheel drive models. And again, the Experience trim gets this silver contrast right here, also in special finishing. So it's more like a rough surface, very interesting. But the basic form styling will be the same also for the other trims. Just this area will be painted differently, for example, than dark or black in the FR. And then this element here, I think it could count as like overall off-road spoiler element. With a lot of fantasy, you can maybe say it's fake exhaust-ish. I don't know. I think it's not a clear case for the fake exhaust pulleys here. Or what's your take? At least the real exhaust is then here underneath, right down there. But they really pulled it all the way down that you cannot see it. And here with the rear lights, you can see here, also nice that you have the turning indicator here in the cascading style now. Now to the engine lineup, which is a little bit simpler now. No gas strut here, but I think we can live with that at this price point. So, starts turbo petrol engine, 1 liter three-cylinder, 110 horsepower. Then there's your 1.5 turbo petrol engine with 150 horsepower, optional DSG, dual clutch transmission. Then the top petrol engine is this one here, the 2 liter TFSI or TSI with 190 horsepower. And this one always comes with DSG, with a dual clutch transmission, and also always comes with the all-wheel drive. And diesels, 2 liter TDI, 115 horsepower or 150 horsepower. And the latter one, optional DSG or DSG and all-wheel drive. So two all-wheel drive versions. However, no other electrification or so on, no mild hybrid technology. They could have taken it, for example, from the Golf early on, but they didn't. So engine-wise, it's a little bit more old school, although it's just have been facelifted. Car key. It's somewhat old school and standard, but this is actually a very good key fob overall. You know, we've been used to it from a lot of Volkswagen AG vehicles. It still does the job. Of course, also keyless entry is available. Put your hand on the outside then or on the inside then to open it, and door closing sound. Wow, that's how it's done. A very solid door closing sound. Really cool. And then inside of the doors, there's new, you know, like soft touch material available, for example, that's also like dampened at behind. The soft part also here at the top part, at least in the front. Quite notable door pocket, optional Beats sound system, the new Experience entry badge for this new off-roadish top trim. So either this off-roadish top trim or the FR, the sporty top trim as usual. The Experience also gets this X stamped, well, sorry, not stemmed. This is X on the steering, but this is also different than before. This is just like, you know, like paint or something. So this is not a real thing to touch anymore. That's maybe a little drawback. Consistency on the inside of the steering wheel. You see the steering wheel is all new, with the new controls. We also know from new Leon and the Golf. For example, here you can set the 10 kilometer steps on the steering wheel for the cruise control. And here with that one, with the zoom or set, you do plus or minus 1 kilometer, and here you can also activate the lane keeping assist. Interesting that the new assistance systems work together with this new steering wheel. It's now capacitive, so it means you don't have to do a steering command, that it still realizes you're active. Just touch the steering wheel with one hand, or better two, then the car still knows you're there, and it's better than for the lane keeping assist, so-called, but they would call it travel assist at Volkswagen, and works up to a speed of 210 kilometers. So more sophisticated assistance systems now. And when you let go of the steering wheel, it takes about 25 seconds. Then the emergency braking assist would be active. That is also standard with the vehicle. And 5 seconds less, by the way, if you also use the towing hook in the rear. Interesting. And about seating, base would be a fabric seat, which is also totally fine. And in the higher trims, the experience here, or also FR, would be that you have a mix of fabric and Alcantara. So both for experience and FR, and both also recommended. This is the optional animal skin equipment, which is bad for practical reasons because it gets hot in summer and cold in winter. And of course, also for ethical reasons, not the appropriate choice. But we really have to say that the Seat Ateca offers a lot of different choices in fabric and Alcantara, and they're also very attractive. We know that also from before. The seat form itself is upright, and you know, you feel you're in a compact vehicle, but then again, a little bit more higher, a little bit more upright than with normal hatch, for example, and that gives you a little bit more comfort, especially for tall people. Here also the electric seat. It starts with a manual seat, optional and electric. This is a lumbar support, also electric here. And it's pretty comfortable seating position. And you already feel like you would be in a grown-up SUV, although it's not so big on the outside. With 1.86 or 6'1", you can see here there's still enough headroom left. Although this one is also equipped with the optional panoramic roof, which is a nice feature, definitely. It always leaves more light inside, and the opening is actually also quite wide, so as close as it comes to SUV convertible in this case. Yeah, look at that. So for, you know, this size of a vehicle, really a very large panoramic roof. You see it still works. It's always a question with the panoramic roofs. If you live in a very, very hot country, then of course a fixed roof is still better in summer. Other than that, and it's always a moving part, you know? So there's always some, let's say, like a risk, but it's also a modern panoramic roof, so I think I would still go for it. It's just a little bit more fun. Steering wheel, by the way, manual control here, up and down and in and out, so you can really find a good position here as well. And soon we'll take another look at these instruments, new screens and so on. By the way, the top part here of the dashboard is also soft touch. And look at the design lines here, which I've put in this material. This is also another nice feature. It's nothing that would cost too much in production, but still it gives a little bit more touch to that top dashboard. Now the interior overview. Again, you can see the design lines here, which are in this one piece. It's really interesting. And then this typical split here, we also know from the older Leon generation that there's no gap here between the lower part and the upper part, because this has this horizontal style and then this is vertical style. So that's a clean solution, I think. Here again, also a view at the new steering wheel. Heated function is now also available, by the way. And on the right side also, you can change the view of these digital instruments. In general, it's like this. It comes standard with analog gauges with a small 3.5 TFT on the inside, and then optional these 10.25 digital gauges. Soon more details to that. And on the right side, you start with the 8.25 smaller screen, but then also with two manual knobs, according to my information. And then optional this year, 9.2-inch, the top infotainment screen, a little bit bigger. Both sizes, however, will feature Apple CarPlay and Android Auto. CarPlay also wireless, and soon also we are going to examine this new software generation. And then, thanks to the automotive god, yes, still manual climate dials here. So this is of course then a big difference to the new Leon or Golf generation and so on. And it's so easy to use them. Ah, that's a relief. So just the temperature and the vent, and why not? I mean, it doesn't look fancy. It looks old school, yes. But it has a reason. It's so easy to use while driving. Seat heating here as well. And by the way, this bright deco element, also matte style, is featured here in the experience. The downside would be it looks a little bit like the deco element that was available for the previous Tiguan generation. The upside is no piano black here, you know, or less piano black at least. And that's of course cool, because no matter what you touch here and there, it does not leave any fingerprints. Then two USB-C devices then here in the front to connect your smartphone. There's also an inductive charging pad that, and you know, enough space also for bigger smartphones. The start-stop engine button has this Jaguar-inspired heartbeat function that, you know, like the car is alive. Then the DSG shifting lever. To me, it looks a little bit shorter now from a dual clutch transmission. And then you have the known drive selector here for example, sports mode, changing the throttle input, and also then the DCC, dynamic chassis control, suspension when you have it equipped with, or also an off-road mode that is drawing back the stability control a little bit, so also easy to pick it. Then the cup holders are not adaptive, but they fit different sizes of bottles, so you can make it yourself adaptive a little bit. Let's take it that way. And then there's the armrest, leatherette cover, and you put it up, and some mass space underneath. Now deals with the new infotainment software. This one indeed looks similar than we know from the new Golf or the new Leon. You have two different main menus, either this one with this app view, that I think, you know, you can get along with it. And then there's this home screen additional menu. You can say it's like an addition. I always say software engineers couldn't decide what they should do, so they offer two main menus. What do you think? And then you have the hotkeys here in the lower part. Yeah, I think this new software, it doesn't give you the best overview what to do. Here on the left side, there's for the volume. Yeah, with the smaller screen, you still have the knob then. That's better, I think. But here you can still use on the steering wheel. This is here the shortcut to the Apple CarPlay or Android Auto. That's good to have it, definitely. And it's also easily accessible. And this is the shortcut then to the GPS system. Yeah, so I'm not the fan of the new software. I think the older one gave you a better overview, actually. And, you know, how to control everything and so on. I find this system here not the most intuitive one. So, however, most of the time, I would leave it actually then in the CarPlay mode, just like this. And this is a good integration. Here we go. And interesting also as for the sound system, because here there's a sound, the beat sound system optional, and there you can activate the surround sound, and of course always all the way. Let's test that. How that one? Yeah, CarPlay. There we go. Let's see. A little bit louder. Yeah, I mean, it's quite clear. Also speaker in the top part here. I mean, I'm not overwhelmed, but definitely satisfied. And here we can also see, taking a look at the map, this is actually quite responsive. I think that's fine. Maybe it could be a little bit faster, but I think it gives us a good overview and a clear view also what we're doing in the map. Now the digital instruments here, by the way, the heated steering wheel has three different levels. Yeah, that's fancy. And then you can have these, you know, modern gauge style, for example. You can have the map in the middle part, and also at the same time in the middle infotainment screen, there's no problem. This analog view, so to say. Now like this. So different styles are available, and then you can always change what's happening in the inside here, for example, like this, or also when I change the view once again. So I think this is actually a quite good overview, and you can also then, you know, zoom in inside the map just by the thumb at the steering wheel. Overall, here on the left side, a good solution. And there's also a new voice input you can activate at the steering wheel, or use this signal or signature saying, in this case then Spanish, hola, hola. Here we go. And then, for example, fahre mich zur Hanauer Landstraße 10, Frankfurt. Let's see. Set to German here at the moment. Now it's calculating.
Bitte nennen Sie die vollständige Adresse, beginnend mit dem Ort.
Frankfurt, Hanauer Landstraße 10. So. Try the address once more.
There we go.
Okay, it's like number 11. Okay, so you see, this can actually then help you with the GPS input. It's not the most natural system, not the most sophisticated one, but at least it can be helpful. As for the rear here, instead of the doors, the top part is hard pack, but then this is also again softened up in all versions, by the way. So like when what you feel in tattoo, what's behind it, this is also a facelift change. And by the way, there's also a double layer here. You can see this is like an insulation layer right here. And there's another one at the inside of the door. So when you close the vehicle, and here's like a third one. So when you close the vehicle, then this is here applied like here. And the overall effect is that there won't be any dirt at the inside of the door. So when you take a seat inside and you slip your legs in there, for example, you don't make your clothes dirty. Very interesting. So, and then rest of the back part here, rear compartment has some kind of a single seat set up, visually at least. Of course, you can still use the middle seat as well. And there are two USB-C chargers now in the middle part. This is one of the facelift changes. Other than that, the legroom, of course, just remains the same. But that's also one of the key factors of this vehicle. Again, it's not pretty long, but still offers a very decent legroom. That's the position as I would be driving. So really very good result. And you sit very upright and comfortable here also in the rear, even with the panoramic roof with 1.86 or 6.1. This is no problem. And so the overall package of this vehicle, exterior-interior relation, is really good. If you compare a Volkswagen Tiguan, by the way, the only thing you do not have here is a slidable bench. So that's a fixed bench. The Tiguan would have the possibility to move the bench forward and backward, but I think you're also just fine here with that. Isofix at the outside seats each. There's no cover for that here, but then it's also easily accessible. And you do flip the seat already from here. In the middle part, you have this folding armrest with non-adaptive cup holders and also ski hatch possibility, like this. Here we go. So overall, I think a very good rating here. And by the way, nowadays car manufacturers tend to save some money also that they make these handles either completely disappear, or when they're not disappear, that they're not dampened. But here you can see four handles here all over the car, and they're also dampened when you let them slip back. That's, you know, that's how it's supposed to be. So to open the rear hatch, you can press the button underneath here. You can use your key fob, or you can also use the foot kick opening mechanism. Here we are. Oh, it worked first time. Very good. I'm not that good at it, you know. Sometimes it works, sometimes not. But here, actually quite well done. You can see here, by the way, I can stand underneath it almost 1.86 or 6.1. That's good. And by the way, if you want to, you know, don't want to have it all the way opened, but like this, maybe your basement garage is limited like this, then you just press and hold the closing button here. Then you heard the sound, and then it will stay exactly in this position when it opens like this the next time. And then you can also manually push it open. Yeah, maybe not the best for the motors here, but they also survive. It's a car after all. Here then, the boot volume is 485 or 510 liters. It depends on, this is the all-wheel drive version. So the Haldex clutch that is transporting front-wheel drive plus all-wheel drive to the torque to the rear, that reduces a little bit of the boot space, but you'll still be fine. And maximum boot space when we flip everything, fold everything, is 1,605 liters. Soon showing you that. Here underneath, you can still fit a replacement tire, even though there's additional sound equipment underneath. And the basic measurements here in length, this is about 85 centimeters. So that's the only thing where this car is limited in comparison to bigger SUVs, that the trunk is not that long. But then again, it's a handy car. So 1 meter almost in width, and the height here to the top cover is about 40. Well, I mean, if you take the higher part here, it's a little bit more than 50 centimeters even. So actually quite good. And now let's fold the seat, and I would say I will use the force. Well, the force seems to be strong with me today. So on the total length here, then now to my driving position would be a little bit more than 1.60 meters. And so just that you can see some luggage inside, this would be a standard backpack, and that is easily fitting here underneath. Oh, just found one more thing. Yeah, it's a real power plug here at the left side. It's of course quite cool. And also the 12-volt power supply, so you can also maybe, you know, put some air into your stand-up paddle boat. And here's the electric release for the towing hook, if you need that. And it looks really, I mean, look at this, how it's placed, you know, kind of between that, it looks really funny when it pops out. So there we are, and it's actually the same way then to release it back again. There we go. And now the child safety test. It is quite strong. As for the closing mechanism, it closes quite quickly. What will happen? Although it closes quickly, I mean, I did feel that, but still, obviously the safety sensors did work. And now to our conclusion for today with the new Seat Ateca facelift. First of all, the new front, very likable and a stronger stance on the road. This one here today, the experience trim level, the new one. At a later stage, we look forward to present you also the FR trim level, how that one looks like with the new face. The dimension, of course, haven't changed. And I think that's also the key about this vehicle. So it's not that long on the exterior, but it offers a lot of space on the interior, especially in the passenger cabin. So overall, it's still one of the best price performance choices as for the compact SUVs on the market. What is also new in the facelift is, of course, digital infotainment stuff and so on in the interior. You have a little bit more flexibility, a little bit more choices. However, I think the one before was also just fine. So software-wise, especially in the central infotainment system, I think that's rather a step back. I like the software before a little bit better. It was just easier to use. However, on the instrument side, I think that's actually then totally fine. And when you're using the Apple CarPlay and your auto all the time anyway, then it's also not a massive change for you. At least we still have the climate knobs. Then a little bit more of the detailing, for example, these painted wheel arches here, or let's say with this special coating in the experience trim. You know, these are, I think, very interesting details. Major upgrades will, of course, be the assistance systems. That's definitely a plus, which are working more sophisticated than before. And also then with the capacitive steering wheel, this will be something you can then enjoy also for everyday driving life. Then as for the engines, it's a little bit easier from the whole setup, and they're also not bad at all. But I would have wished a little bit more electrification, for example, that they took the 1.5 mild hybrid then from the Golf and Leon. That would have been cool for the facelift, definitely. Well, what do you think here about the new Seat Ateca facelift? We'll of course keep you updated with the driving review very soon, and then also with some other trims. Tune in next time, or of course to some of the competitor reviews. We will always link some interesting reviews here in the video description and also in the pinned comment. Thank you so much for tuning in today. See you next time.